It's the Andy Thompson Show on ESPN 97.7.
Cool. Sports. Let's go, Lawrence. What do we got on a Thursday, my friend?
Skeeter Beaters on the Andy Thompson Show.
And Claire coming the other way. And Hendricks, former lottery pick out of UCF. They're looking for him to take the next step. Here's Hendricks launching from deep, and he nails the three.
And they want him to be shot ready. When you shoot it, shoot it with conviction. That's exactly what Coach talked about.
Shot ready.
Sport Hall. Your Skeeter Beaters have been horrible. What do you got tonight?
Well, we've missed a couple of them recently, right?
Yes.
We missed yesterday. We missed the Indiana Fever. And then on Tuesday, we missed the All-Star game. So we're over.
Yes.
I can't remember the last time we got one of these right. We're doing a summer league game. Clippers -4.5 versus the Jazz in Las Vegas. Fuel up the Oldsmobile, Larry. Head down the Chevette Shuffle. Take the back route and get yourself to the Eureka Casino and Resort. Sink your teeth into one of their beautiful smash burgers. And the nachos there are also very good. And you can put a sawbuck down on... Now, wait a minute. Before we give our pick, let's talk a little bit about Taylor Hendricks, who was 9 of 10 in his last game for 23 points. How about Kyle Filipowski, the guy who's been brainwashed, apparently. 9 of 16 from the field, 2 of 3 from 3. He had 20 points, and Cody Williams had 15 points to lead the Jazz. Isaiah Collier, just 6 points on 3 of 9 shooting. He did have 5 assists in their last game in Summer League. Take the Jazz. +4.5. You need the points. Let's go to Katie Rosen for our first hour look at the National News Desk. Katie!
Thanks, guys. To all the listeners out there, I'm on LinkedIn, like for a new job. So give me a shout. From the Sport Hall National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm Katie Rosen. Bronny James has become a popular betting pick for Rookie of the Year. According to reports, Rich Paul threatened bettors that if they didn't bet on Bronny, he'd send them to Australia. Tiger Woods struggled in round one of the Open Championship with an 8-over-79. Quote, does Scotland have a TGI Fridays? He asked after the round. Diana Taurasi, seeking her 6th gold medal with the Team USA Women's Basketball, is a 42-year-old woman. Yeah, way to take Caitlin's spot on the team, you old bag. Today's Sport Hole National News is brought to you by Lawrence's mom. From the Sport Hole National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm Katie Rosen, ESPN 97.7.
Thank you, Katie. Way to stay professional till the end there. You made it through.
The Sport Hole.
Sports.
2-minute drill.
1-0 delivery. Hammered down the line in right field, and it is fair and slides into third for an RBI triple.
Presented by Ideal Home and Auto Paint.
Yeah. Let's do it, Lawrence. Appreciate Ideal Home and Auto Paint helping us bring you this question from Sambo. Go ahead, Sambo. When you're ready.
Sport Hall, what do you expect from Dixie High's defense this year with Coach Rick Barry back in the saddle?
Oh, very good things. Very good things. You know, it's all about high school sports is cyclical, Larry. As they say, it's up and down and personnel is everything and a new school's built. You lose half your team and all that stuff. I thought Dixie's defense is always good and Coach Barry hasn't been there in a while, but everywhere he goes, the defense is good. He's, you know, state championship caliber defense is at Dixie. Won a state championship at Desert Hills with a defense that gave up 18 points a game with a lot of talent on it. Dixie over the last couple years has given up more than that. But I anytime you watch Dixie play, you've got Coach Monker's on one side, coaching the offense, executing jet sweeping. Quarterback always knows where to go with the ball. Now, sometimes they have more talent than others, just like every other team. But Dixie's always coached really well, I guess is my point. And I'm excited to see Coach Barry return to teaming up with Coach Monker's for the Dixie Flyers. And I think you're going to see I think you're going to see good defense. Okay. I mean, I think you're going to see great defense with the Flyers this year. Last time Coach Barry was in Region 9 was when he won a state championship. The year before that, he went undefeated in Region 9 play as the head coach at Desert Hills. They're teaming up over at Dixie. It's kind of like, kind of seems unfair because you've got Coach Ilofipo and Coach Stokes. Those are pretty good tandems in Region 9 this year with a lot of experience coaching and winning. So that's going to be a fun matchup when Crimson and Dixie play this year. Because you think about all four of those guys were all at Dixie High at one point, right? In fact, I think if you go back to when Coach Monkers, before he left, his first stint there, that was Barry, and that may have been Coach Wayne and Coach Stokes coaching the lower levels over at Dixie High. So that'll be a nice reunion to have all four of them coaching in the same game. Great stuff there, Larry.
Yes.
Thank you.
Take a knee, boys.
Grab a knee on the Andy Thompson Show.
All right, let's go. Who do we got? This is brought to you by CoverItStorage.com. We preview a opponent of an in-state college program in the upcoming year. What do we got, Larry?
Head coach Willie Fritz.
This is a name that only real ball coaches really seem to understand. He's won everywhere he went. Blinn Junior College, D2 Central Missouri State, FCS Sam Houston State, Georgia Southern Tulane, now getting a shot at the big leagues. Willie Fritz is a ball coach, and he's nothing but a winner.
Is that Houston?
Sport Hall. Let's preview the Houston Cougars with new head coach Willie Fritz this season.
Well, Willie Fritz comes from Tulane. Tulane liked to pound the rock, Larry. They ran the ball like crazy. He's going to try to bring that to Houston, who has been traditionally airing it out, air raid. Holgorsen most recently with Clayton Toon and Donovan Smith, who's the guy that they've got coming back from last year. And Fritz is going to say, no, we're going to run the ball. We're going to come into the Big 12 and show that we can be. Look, we're little old Houston that nobody cares about. But we're going to put our hand in the dirt and we're going to run the ball a little bit. 30, 40 times a game is what he was running it at Tulane, where he had a lot of success. So that's an interesting little quirk, because Houston has never been that type of team. He's recruiting really well, and anytime a coach is recruiting well now, it's like, oh, they must be getting a ton of NIL support, especially if they're at a mid-tier program like Houston. So he's got, I think he's, in the most recent recruiting rankings, he's third in the Big 12 and top 25 in the country at Houston, so that's pretty good. It kind of goes to what a lot of people think, which is Houston is a sleeping giant, Larry. Have you heard that before?
Yes.
Because they're in Houston. And that's a lot of football talent in Houston, Texas. That's usually rated by the SEC, LSU, Arkansas, Alabama, everybody else. Of course, Texas and Texas A&M. But if Houston can kind of announce themselves as a Power Four program who's competent and keep some of those Houston kids at the University of Houston, then they could be. It's kind of the same story that SMU has in Dallas. You're in these talent-rich places, and finally, you're in a power conference. Does your recruiting step up enough? Does your boosters and NIL step up enough to help you keep some of that talent at home? And that's what Fritz has said, that he likes being in Houston because he doesn't have to get on an airplane to recruit, Larry. He just drives around. And there's a million high schools down there with a bunch of players. So they play Utah on October 26th. That game will be in Houston. They play BYU November 30th at BYU. And this is a team that BYU can beat. It's a team that Utah can beat and probably BYU needs to beat this year, I would say. I think they're counting. If BYU is going to get the over on the 4.5 wins this year, Houston's got to be one of them, right?
Yes.
So we'll see if Fritzy and the boys, because it wasn't good last year. They had, you know, remember a couple years ago in the AAC where they won double-digit games with Holgorsen. Everybody thought the Skolit was back. And then he was, last year, had a tough season in their first year in the Big 12, like BYU did. And like every, you know, UCF and Cincinnati did as well. And then they were like, Holgorsen, get the heck out. Go back to the trailer park we found you in. And Holgorsen is fallen on hard times, but we'll see if Fritz can kind of bring the program, turn him around. They're not going to be good this year, but I believe, just like the guy said, the audio you played, he's been good at other places. Maybe he can turn him around, Larry.
No.
Anything else on Houston?
No.
For the Big 12, if the Big 12 is to stay together, Larry, long term, and it doesn't become the Super 70 league, let's say in the next 3 or 4 years or whatever. Let's say it's a long-term league. They need Houston to get good. They need SMU's in the freaking ACC. They need UCF to get good, who's in a big, talent-rich, 70,000-student school and all that stuff, Space City. And Cincinnati, they need them to kind of get back to where they were just a few years ago with Fickle. And some of the, and BYU, of course. So they need these newcomers to get better and better, and that'll just add to the parity. This is the parity conference, the Big 12, the parity conference. Everybody's about even. That's good. But it gets even better if these new additions can be 7-8 win type teams every year. And I think they can. All right, there's Houston.
The Sport Hall.
Sports, 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 sports.
Thunder's out of timeouts. Adams gives it back to Rush. Deep shot. Get it! What a perfect ending to a historic day. Westbrook gives the Thunder the victory at the buzzer.
Sport Hall. How will Russell Westbrook help the Nuggets this year?
Not at all. Understand. Apparently, Jokic wants to play with Westbrook. I don't understand. Like, at least Carmelo at the tail end of his career, when he finally, they had to beat him to get him to agree to be like a bench player, at least he was like a catch and shoot guy. You know, he didn't need all of his young athleticism to still be good. Westbrook, he can't shoot. And they're thinking, we lost because of the second apron thing with the salary cap, and Adam Silver's making it impossible to keep good teams together and keep all of your players if you want to make a dynasty run. We had to get rid of Caldwell Pope. So we need somebody on the bench to spark us. We need somebody on the bench who can lead the second unit. And so they think, oh, let's go get Russell Westbrook. Judas Priest. Why are they doing that, Larry? I don't think Westbrook can do that. I think we've seen him, and I feel bad for him because he's had a tough run. I mean, the Clippers thing was a disaster. Everywhere has been a disaster. The Lakers was a disaster. The Rockets wasn't very good. So he's not the kind of guy to have a second run on his career where he adapts and plays a different way and team-oriented and doing what's best for the... He's just a guy that goes and bungles up possessions and the ball sticks with him and, you know, the other guys don't like playing with him very much is what my view on Westbrook is. A guy who's never won and I don't think will help the Nuggets win. So I thought they were too smart to do that, but they're also just desperate for somebody coming off the bench probably, right?
Yes.
We'll get Rustin's take on that as well. And also how Rustin feels about Westbrook once again leaving the Jazz. And if Rustin is, if he's burning his Russell Westbrook Jazz jersey.
Letter to the Sport Hole. You can write to the Sport Hole at 937-76.
All right, this is Dalton. We got a character letter, Larry.
Yes.
All right, this is from brought to you by CoveritStorage.com. If you got a boat or an RV and you're looking to cover it up this summer, Cover It Storage has you covered at CoveritStorage.com. Dear Sport Hole, Larry, Katie, and Sambo. You got the whole crew, Larry.
Yes.
Could you believe that the WNBA All-Star Game is not going to have Caitlin Clark or Sabrina Ionescu competing in a three-point competition? How is this even possible? Yada, yada, yada. Yeah, that's the main question. Sincerely, Dalton. It's a great question. Here's Caitlin Clark interviewed like yesterday about that.
Focused on getting a win right before the Olympic break. Was just curious if the league has reached out to you at all about the three-point contest.
Yeah, I don't know. My focus is on this game tonight, and then we'll turn to All-Star, and then after that, but need to be Dallas, so.
So she doesn't answer the question. She's focusing on Dallas. By the way, she had a 19 assists last night to break a WNBA record. This is inexcusable, Larry. She's not in the three-point competition. The only person who anybody wants to see in the three-point competition isn't in it. And neither is the second person people would like to see, Ionescu, who's the one who competed against Steph Curry in the men's All-Star game. This is malfeasance. This is complete negligence by the WNBA. And the WNBA might come out and say, look, we asked her to. She didn't want to. That doesn't matter. You're the league. You're the committee. You got to force her to do this crap. Because you're trying to build this league, and it's all the same stuff that I was talking about and many people were talking about when it came out she didn't make the U.S. women's team. You're trying to build women's basketball. Why do you keep submerging yourself and undercutting your product by not giving your audience what they want? All they want is Caitlin Clark. She's on the All-Star team. She's going to be there. She must compete in the three-point competition. You got to redo it. They already released who the roster is for the three-point competition. Scrap it. Force her to do it. And redo the who's going to compete. This is gross negligence by the WNBA. And once again, it is a decision, Larry, by a business that doesn't have to feel the consequences of bad business decisions. As we're talking about them getting $200 million a year potentially and a $2 billion contract with their new TV rights deal, and they're finally starting to make their own money, it's time to start making good business decisions, which is having your biggest asset, head and shoulders above it, and the other WNBA players hate to hear this, but she's your number one star, head and shoulders above anybody else. She's got to be everywhere. She's got to be in the Olympics. She's got to be at every contest. She's got to be in the All-Star game. You got to showcase her at every turn, and they're failing to do that. Once again, I could not believe this. Wouldn't that be fun to watch her go against Ionescu in the three-point competition?
Yes.
I don't know the names of the girls that are in it that were listed. Do you?
Yes.
No, you don't. Do you?
No.
So, I'm with you, Dalton. And I think everybody is. It's very disappointing. And you can blame Caitlin if it was up to her and she said, no, I don't. I need a rest. I don't want to compete in this, or it'll be embarrassing if I don't win or whatever. It's kind of like how LeBron never competed in a dunk contest. I remember him doing a dunk contest when he was a high school kid at the McDonald's thing, maybe, or the thing they do right around March Madness, and he was unbelievable. And then he never did it as a pro, which was inexcusable. But the NBA was the NBA. This is the WNBA, and you need every opportunity to showcase. So either Caitlin pooched it or the WNBA pooched it. Judging by that thing you just played, Larry, play that audio again, Lawrence.
Focused on getting a win right before the Olympic break. Was just curious if the league has reached out to you at all about the 3-point contest.
Yeah, I don't know. My focus is on this game tonight, and then we'll turn to All-Star, and then after that, but need to be Dallas. So
that makes it seem like she doesn't want to answer the question. Makes it seem like, to me, that it's her decision. She doesn't want to do it. So that's on Caitlin, but it's also on the league. You have the power, or you should have the power, to just go to her and force her to do it. Right, Larry?
Yes.
Thank you.
Pandering local poll of the day.
Sport Hole. Who are the top five college football fan bases who hate their rival more than they like themselves?
Great question. We got a top five list, Larry?
Yes.
So this is top five college football programs who hate their rival more than they like themselves, their own team, right?
Yes.
All right, let's do it.
Number five.
All right, number five is UCLA football. UCLA, nobody cares about UCLA football. Nobody. When they play their opening game the first week of September in the Rose Bowl, there's going to be like 9,000 people in attendance in a stadium that holds 90,000. UCLA football sucks, and their fan base sucks. And none of their fans have any passion about UCLA. They just know they're supposed to hate USC. So, yes, UCLA's number five.
Number four.
Number four, we're going either Pitt or West Virginia. Backyard brawl. I understand there's very passionate West Virginia. I don't know if I agree with this, Larry. There's a lot of passionate West Virginia fans. So let's go with Pitt. Nobody cares about Pitt football since 1977. Nobody. Since Larry Fitzgerald in 2002. Since Kenny Pickett doing the fake slide. Nobody cares about Pitt football. That's a professional city, Pittsburgh. They got four major league sports. You think they care about Pitt? No. What they do know is they have to hate West Virginia. Backyard brawl. For how lame that game or that rivalry is, like it never has any consequence to it. It's never a big game. Both of these teams always are very average, but it's a pretty well-known rivalry because there's a lot of hatred in it, and I believe Pitt hates West Virginia more than it likes Pitt.
Number three
is Texas A&M. Now, this is a hard one because Texas's main rival is Oklahoma. Texas A&M has a self-respecting fan base, Larry. This is another one I'm not sure I 100% agree with because Texas A&M fills out their 100,000 stadium. They got the 12th man. They got history. They have never been super good. I know they hate Texas, but don't they love Aggie football a lot?
Yes.
I don't know if I agree with that one. I'm scratching that one from the list. Texas A&M is out of there. All right, let's go to number two.
Number two.
This one's going to hoit, Larry. The University of... Oh, we already did the drum roll, I guess. Utah. Utah fans hate BYU in every sport more than they love themselves. Now, that's changing. Utah, over the past decade and a half, has earned a lot of self-respect and love for themselves in the Whittingham era and the stadium renovations and the must and the winning and the Rose Bowls and stuff like that. But I would still say, and I know I'm close to it, and that's why they're number two on my stupid list here, Larry, but Utah fans hate BYU more than they love Utah. And if you look at the other side of the coin, that's not the same for BYU. I wouldn't say. BYU fans love BYU more than they hate Utah. Which side of that are you on, Larry? Are you a Utah guy?
No.
You're a BYU guy?
No.
Oh, okay. So you're you got to choose one. You're in the Beehive State. So Utah's number two. Let's go to number one.
And at number one,
Auburn. The Auburn-Alabama rivalry, one of the best. I mean, the fact that it's in the running for the best rivalry in college football when there's so much disparity and imbalance in the rivalry speaks to how great it is, because Michigan-Ohio State is even. You know, that's why that's a great rivalry. Notre Dame and USC, even. That's why that's a great rivalry. Oklahoma-Texas, even. Auburn, compared to Alabama, is a dwarf. Yet, it's still on top of a lot of people's rivalry list just because of the passion and, you know, poisoning trees and, what's the name of the corner? Tumors Corner. Ah. What is it, Larry? Can you look that up?
Yes.
So, Auburn's whole identity is wrapped around being Alabama's little brother and hating Alabama. And that has been amplified in the Saban era because Alabama's always been the best team in the country. And then Auburn went and got themselves a national title and went to another national title. So they are climbing and making it somewhat more even than it's maybe ever been when it comes to the Iron Bowl. So very good. I think we got number one right. I'm not sure about some of the others. If you got better ones, text us at 435-900 3776. This is football only, right?
Yes.
Because I would say Michigan and Ohio State, they both love their programs. Any of the Notre Dame rivalries, Oregon, Oregon State. I mean, you could say any of these huge disparity in-state rivalries like Oregon State, Oregon, or like Wazoo, UW. But I think Oregon in Corvallis, there's a lot of passion and self-respect. That's a self-respecting program. And I would say the same for Wazoo. And I don't think the hatred for UW by Wazoo fans is as vitriolic as Auburn, Alabama, and some of these other ones. Larry, I bet if you talk to people around here, I'm thinking of a guy right now, a Big Apple Cup guy, who would say, no, we hate Washington. So honorable mention, I guess. There. Thank you.
The Sport Hole.
Sports, 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 sports.
Porthole. What did you think of the top 25 in the top 100 athletes according to ESPN's little list they put out?
Well, I didn't like that Michael Phelps was number one. So Michael Phelps is number one, greatest athlete since the year 2000. And we've talked about this a lot. Serena Williams is number two. Messi's number three. Let's see, Larry. LeBron's number four. Now, that's the biggest problem, is LeBron's ahead of Brady. So Brady's number five. You know, my problem with Phelps being always high on these lists is that he had a chance to win a ton of medals, because in swimming, there's a million different strokes. And so if Usain Bolt had a chance to have 10 different types of fast races, okay, this one you skip a little bit, Usain, and then this one you do the chicken wing as you're going down or whatever, he probably would have won, you know, 7 medals in Olympics or something like that. Swimmers would say, well, no, because he had to go different lengths. He had to do the backstroke. He had to do the breaststroke. He had to do whatever else. And he won them all, and he won the relay. So I'm cool with Phelps being the great. I mean, because if you compare Phelps to the other great swimmers like Mark Spitz, Phelps has like 28 medals. And Spitz has like 11 or something. So he's Hercules, Larry. He's by far the greatest. It's just hard to put an Olympian number one to me because they're only in your life for like a month total. In all the different Olympic seasons he was in, he's only there. He's only in your life for a few days. Whereas Brady is week in, week out on the gridiron, winning 7 Super Bowls. On my list, Brady's number one. I think Serena is fine at number two because of how much she dominated her sport, even though she doesn't have, you'd think she'd have the most of everything, the most major wins, the most regular wins, but I don't think she does. We need to look all that up. But she's by far the most dominant women's tennis player ever. So I'm cool. I'm cool with her number two. If you gotta throw a bone to soccer, Messi, I think, is considered not only the greatest player since 2000, but maybe the greatest player ever in a lot of modern people's mind, even more than Pele. So I'm cool. I'm not cool with LeBron at 4 or Brady at 5. Federer at 6, best men's player, fine. Simone Biles, once again, Olympians, hard to judge. She was great. How? I guess my question to you, Larry, is how much better is Simone Biles than any other Olympic gymnast? And I know this is the list is only since the year 2000s, but just relative to other gymnasts, how much better was Simone's career? They got Tiger at 8. That's probably a problem, Larry. I know from 96 to 2000, he won a bunch of tournaments, but 13 major wins since the year 2000. I probably got a problem with Tiger being 8. I mean, Tiger's got to be above LeBron, right? He's probably got to be above Simone. He's got to kind of be in Messi territory, I believe. Usain Bolt, Olympian, he ran like 7 races. They got Kobe at 10. I got a problem with that. Djokovic. And then Nadal, 11 and 12. Ronaldo, 13. Steph Curry, 14. Katie Ledecky, 15. Tim Duncan, 16. Shaquille O'Neal, 17. Patrick Mahomes, 18. Lewis Hamilton, F1, 19. Aaron Donald, 20. Diana Taurasi, 21. Sidney Crosby, 22. Kevin Garnett, 23. Albert Pujols, 24. Floyd Mayweather, 25. Why is Kevin Garnett number 23? He won one championship? That is super high for Garnett. Why is he 23, Larry? Look that up, will you?
Yes.
What other NBA players are behind Garnett? I mean, Peyton Manning is behind Kevin Garnett, and Randy Moss is behind Garnett. Randy Moss is the greatest receiver to ever play the game. Garnett isn't close to the greatest anything in NBA history, right? That's kind of egregious, Lawrence. I don't understand the KG thing there. All right, we got to move on.
Listener voicemail. Call us with your inane observations at 900-3776.
All right, we got a character. We got a character VM, Larry?
Yes.
All right, go ahead.
Sport hole, Larry, Sam, Katie. Wondering if you saw a little bit of the open highlights or if you stayed up late last night to watch the first round. Chef Lier. In the top 10 or 11 or so, Finau shot even his round one. What do you think about the likelihood that Shefford wins or, you know, Finau wins?
Judas Priest. Look, we're cheering for Tony. He's even. Scheffler is kind of on a historic run, so I kind of always cheer for history in golf. Rory's already pooched it. Bryson's pooched it. Tiger's pooched it. So, to me, it's kind of... I'd like to see Finau win, and then probably Scheffler.
Do you likey?
Do You Like It is brought to you by our good friends at Balance of Nature. Check out balanceofnature.com. What do you got, Sambo?
Sport Hole. Whose side are you on? Paul Feinbaum or Lane Kiffin?
Incorrect guilt that you tried to lay on me, which preceded that move. Had something to do with Southern California.
Oh, yeah. When you got me fired at USC, I got myself fired at USC, but you didn't help.
It's a better story if I got you fired.
You really did. Because it is a true story that the athletic director and the president were on that trip. We were playing that night, and you were on college game day, and you had to make your big splash, and they were watching it, because I know the other person in the room that was watching it with them, and you said, what a joke I was, and I'm the Miley Cyrus of college football coaching, and I should be fired, and they looked at each other, and later that night, I was fired.
Yeah, by the way.
So, but hey, look what happened. I would have never gotten to work for Coach Saban. All these other things wouldn't happen. So I appreciate you for helping getting me fired. Thank you.
I mean, look at what you're doing today. You're predicted to go to the playoffs. And look at Miley Cyrus. She's had a nice comeback.
So you're wrong on that. I mean, you like putting me down with that. So really, I don't really know what you're good at. Like, you predicted that Coach Saban was done. That didn't happen. You basically said Miley Cyrus stinks, and she's still going.
Yeah. Well, anyway, it's always great to be ridiculed by Lane Kiffin here at SEC Meet.
I enjoy Lane Kiffin. I appreciate his shtick, and I'm cheering for him with Jackson Dart and the boys at Ole Miss. Apparently, somebody said, is that Feinbaum saying they're predicted to maybe go to the playoff this year? That's not going to happen. They're going to win 9 games at most, like they always do. But I appreciate Kiffin because he's a little punk, but he subverts the typical old ball coach, super serious stuff and mocks that. So I enjoy Lane Kiffin. And I think the thing I saw was like this big, Feinbaum and Kiffin having it out at SEC. And it's a joke. They're kidding around. They're friends. They're buddy-buddy. So, but I do like Kiffin. All right, let's go, Larry.
Happy, happy, happy.
Happy 84th birthday to the great Joe Torre. Born in 1940, American Baseball Hall of Fame manager. Won the World Series in 96, 98, 99, 2000 with the Yankees. Was an NL MVP and batting champion in 1971. Gold Glove Award in 65 with the Braves. And St. Louis Cardinals, born in Brooklyn, New York. Happy birthday, Joe Torre, one of the greats. Quick break, back with more right after this on the Andy Thompson Show with Rustin Burnside. Thanks for being with us.